Hello all. Today we will talk about Aegean art, Cycladic, Minoan and Mycenaean. The period is from 2600 to 1100 BC. In this lesson, our objectives are acquaint the student about the significance of Aegean art and architecture in the said period. Understand in detail about the different periods in Aegean history and circumstances that led to the production of art. Appreciate the art and architecture of the empire in the said period. As the title suggests, we shall be discussing the art and architecture of the following civilization: Cycladic art, 2600 to 1100 BC. Minoan art, circa 3000 to 1100 BC. Mycenaean art, 1600 to 1100 BC. Let me introduce to you the region and other aspects. Towards the end of the 3rd millennium BC, a flourishing civilization with a vast potential for expansion, thanks to its maritime trade links, developed on the island of Crete and in the Cycladic island to the north. Highly original works of art produced in this area were to become models for the Mycenaean culture a few centuries later. Aegean art is that art that has made in the Greek lands surrounding and the islands within the Aegean Sea. It includes the art that was created by different cultures of Cycladians, Minoans and Mycenaeans. These cultures were highly unique. Their works range from triangular, almost abstract depiction of form, to breezy depiction of nature, to sturdy architectural innovations to their citadels, a form of Levantine Bronze Age art. These cultures and their art emerged at the same time as the Assyrian and Babylonian civilization and overlapped the old, middle and new kingdoms of Egypt. It might be interesting to note that despite cultural exchange by way of trade with the contemporaneous civilizations of Egypt and Mesopotamia, the Aegean cultures developed their own highly distinctive styles. Aegeans used metal ores imported from Europe, Arabia and Anatolia, and created exquisite objects of bronze, fetching a high price when exported thanks to their trade links with both the hinterland and the neighboring civilizations. It might be important to know that the Aegean culture was remembered only in myths and legends. Before the late 19th century, you will see that the most of the works of art discussed here have been discovered since 1870. Let us now focus on Cycladic art, 2600 to 1100 BC. The Cyclades are a group of islands in the south of Aegean Sea and are so named because they form a circle, kuklos in Greek. They engaged in agriculture, having permanent settlements belonging to the Neolithic age, and were also accomplished sailors, fishermen and traders. They, however, had no writing system. The early phase of Cycladic art was characterized by ceramics decorated with zigzags, running spirals, and ship motifs that symbolize the marine activity of the region, even before the period of survey. The earliest examples of Asian art appeared in the Cyclades, a group of islands that includes Naxos, Paros, Milos, Santorini, and others. The islands abounded in marble, which provided the ideal material for sculpture of vases and of idols. The most typical of which were female figures, possibly fertility goddesses. They range in height from nearly 5 feet to only a few inches. Today they are called idols because they are thought to have been objects of worship. Most were found lying in graves. It is thought that these figures are meant to be carried in religious processions, as they cannot stand on their own. These idols form a narrow vertical, extending at the back from the top of the head to the buttocks. Legs and feet fall into three slight zigzag planes, and the angle of the feet makes it impossible for them to support the statue. The head is slightly curving rectangle. Its only articulated feature is the long pyramidal nose. But originally, eyes and the mouth are pointed on. The neck is cylindrical and the torso is divided into two squares by the horizontals of the lower arm, with arms folded just under gently protruding. With arms folded just under gently protruding breast, as if they were clutching their abdomens. The right angles of the elbows create a three-sided frame around the upper torso. Although the overriding impression of the shapes is geometric, certain features such as the breasts and knees have a convincing organic quality. They seem to protrude naturally from beneath the exterior surface of the body. All body parts are pared down to essentials, and some joints and junctures are indicated with incised lines. The sculptors carefully designed these figures, laying them out with a compass in conformity to three evenly spaced and equally sized circles, the first delineated by the upper arch of the head and the vest, the second by sloping shoulders and the line of the knees, and the third beginning with the curving limit of the paired feet and meeting the bottom of the upper circles at the waist. Many facial and other details were picked out in paint. Let us now turn to Minoan art, circa 3000 to 1100 BC. By 3000 BC, Bronze Age people were living in Crete, the largest Asian islands, 155 miles long and 36 miles wide, a very convenient location. Crete produced its own food, grains and fruits, had its share of domestic animals and many safe harbors. Crete was a wealthy sea power, trading with mainland Greece, Egypt, the Near East and Anatolia, thus acquiring the ores necessary for producing bronze. The prosperity of this civilization, named Minoan after the legendary king Minos, is evident in the construction of palaces at Knossos, Phaistos and Malia. The Minoans, goddess worshippers, and their culture has been described as being used on a matriarchal religion. Their religion was that of a sophisticated and urbanized palatial culture with a complex social hierarchy. It was not dominated by fertility any more than any religion of the past or present has been. And it addressed gender identity, rites of passage and death. Images of priestesses of bull, double axes, trees, columns and outdoor shrines occur in scenes of religious ceremonies. Trees and pillars were venerated in rites, celebrating the coming of spring and the harvest. Another recurring motif in Minoan art is a goddess or a priestess holding snakes, probably indicating her mastery over animals. Let us look at Minoan palace architecture now. When the first palace at Knossos was destroyed by earthquake in about 1700 BC, the great building which replaced it was constructed round a large central courtyard, reached by the winding passages recalled in the story of the maze labyrinth through the Greek hero Theseus had to thread his way. West of the courtyard were the state rooms, including the audience hall and the main shrines. Behind them lay storerooms with huge clay jars for oil and corn, and recesses in the floor for chests of cloth and treasure. On the opposite side of the courtyard were the private apartments. The upper floor reached by a grand staircase. The plaster ceilings were supported on wooden columns, tapering downwards and brightly painted. The rooms were arranged round small courtyards for light and air, giving the impression of gradual growth rather than regular planning. There was a piped water supply, drains, and form of water closet. You might want to know that these buildings were not fortified, as it was not required on an island, Crete that is. The post and lintel construction was used with low ceilings, stone masonry walls, and short wooden columns that taper downwards. Let us look at the fresco painting here. The so-called Toreador or Leaping Bull fresco is the best known wall painting from Knossos. It represents a charging bull, two girls and one boy. The girl at the left grasps the bull's horns, the boy somersaults over its back, and the girl at the right stands steady to catch him. Given the sacred character of the bull and the myth of the Minotaur, it is believed that this fresco depicts a ritual support possibly involving the sacrifice of the bull and the death of the athletes. As in Egyptian paintings, females are depicted with lighter skin color than males, and a profile head is combined with a frontal eye. In other ways, however, the Minoan painting differ from those of Egypt, primarily in the predominance of curvilinear form and movement of figures in space. Although three different human figures are represented in the Toreador fresco, their poses suggest a sequence of movements that could be made by a single figure. Such dynamic depictions are more characteristic of Minoan art than Egyptian art. The extended legs of the bull are not naturalistic. They are a device known as the flying gallop, used to create an illusion of speed and energy. The border designs simulate colored stones. Let us look at the wall painting at Akrotiri on Thera, one of the most significant paintings of the period. The fresco was painted in a long horizontal strip that extended over windows and doorways. You can see harbors, boats, cities, and villages, human figures, landscapes, sea life, and land animals, all of which provide information about the culture of ancient Thera. You can see the multi-storied houses, the paddled and sailed boats, and the distinct Theran style of clothing. Many interpretations of this painting include the straightforward return to a fleet back home, or a ceremonial ritual. Although there is some overlapping to show depth, the landscape is rendered with no sense of spatial diminution and appears to frame the city. Distance is indicated by proximity to the top of the fresco, boats below, buildings on land and hills, trees and animals at the horizon. And now to pottery. In early Minoan period, ceramics were characterized by linear patterns of spirals, triangles, curved lines, crosses, fishbone motifs, and such. In the Middle Minoan period, naturalistic designs such as fish, squid birds, and lilies were common. In the late Minoan period, flowers and animals were still the most characteristic, but the variability had increased. The hallmarks of this select ceramic ware were its extreme thinness, its use of color, and its graceful, stylized, painted decoration. Minoan pottery indicates a lot of energies through its design. Here, a Camarus ware spouted jar from the older palace at Knossos is covered with lively geometric patterns suggesting its organic nature. The term Camarus is from the Camarus cave in the mountain above Phaistos, where examples of this type of pottery were first discovered. When compared with Egyptian imagery, the Camors example is freer and more curvilinear. The abstract pattern formed by white on the characteristic blue black ground suggests a floral design with its undulating motion and whirling circular arrangements of shapes. A few details are enhanced with orange, which contrasts with the dark blue and add to the vibrant quality of the design. Camors Ware is an art of shape and color in which patterns are integrated in a balanced organic manner with the form of the vessel. The octopus vase from the Palaeocastro is enlivened by a vigorous surface design related to natural forms. Although images of an octopus and other forms of sea life are discernible on the vase, the artist obviously delighted in the ornamental character of the swirling tentacles with little round suction cups. These, in turn, are repeated formally in the large oval eyes of the octopus, which echo the holes made by the handles. And now to Mycenaean art, circa 1600 to 1100 BC. The Mycenaean age is also called the Helladic age. Called the Helladic age from Hellas, the Greek name for Greece, to designate the Asian Bronze Age on mainland Greece. In the early part of the Asian Bronze Age, the Greek-speaking peoples, probably from the northwest, moved into the mainland. They brought with them advanced techniques for metalworking, ceramics, and architectural design, and they displaced the local Neolithic culture. Later in Asian Bronze Age, the people of the mainland city of Mycenae rose to power and extended their influence into the Asian islands as well. Let us talk about the Mycenaean architecture. This culture's art began to move away from the delicate Minoan figures towards a sturdier and realistic depiction of the world. Their portraiture aimed to capture a likeness, and their architecture was massive and strong, meant to appear impenetrable. Cities were designed to be impregnable and were protected by thick walls of massive irregular blocks of stone, which still survive impressively at Tiryns and Mycenae. The city of Mycenae actually comprised a remote hilltop fortress surrounded by a wall up to 20 feet thick, and travelers entered through the lion gate, made up of megaliths weighing several tons. The palace was a rectangular structure called the Megaron. Called the Megaron, a large room in Greek. You would enter the Megaron through a front porch supported by two columns and continued through an antechamber into the throne room, in which four columns surrounded a circular hearth. The king presided in the Megaron, his throne centered and facing the hearth. You will see this aspect elaborated later in Greek temple architecture. The walls and the floors were covered with paintings like the Minoans. The Mycenaeans apparently had no temples separate from the palaces. Shrines have been found within the palaces, which were lavishly decorated and furnished with precious objects and painted pottery. Tombs. The most dramatic surviving structures at Mycenae are the monumental royal tholes, Greek for round building, tombs. The earliest burials were in shaft graves, vertical pits 20 to 25 feet deep. The Mycenae, the graves of important people, were enclosed in a circle of standing stone slabs. In these graves, the ruling families laid out their dead in opulent dress and jewelry and surrounded them with ceremonial weapons, gold and silver pharis, and other articles indicative of their status, wealth and power. The interior view shows the corbelled corpses, which diminish in diameter as they approach the top of the chamber. This is crowned by a round capstone at the center of the huge dome. Once the dead body has been placed inside the tholos, the door was closed and the entrance was walled up with stones until it had to be reopened for later burials. All that would have been visible from exterior was the mound of earth covering the tomb and the dromos. The mask, the so-called Mask of Agamemnon, is good example of the gold work found in royal Mycenaean graves. Although the gold itself was imported, the mask covered the face of a ruler once have been Agamemnon, but in fact his identity is unknown, despite stylization such as the scroll-shaped ears, the more distinctive features, the thin lips and curved mustache seem to be those of a particular person.